Welcome, everyone, to today's Edison Electric Institute webinar, a conversation on energy, climate, and geopolitics with Dr. Daniel Yergin. My name is Vanessa Ferrero, and I am a manager for international programs at EEI. Today's session is part of our virtual conversation series, where we sit down with global experts and discuss the issues affecting our industry. We are delighted to welcome Dr. Daniel Yergin to speak about his latest book, The New Map, Energy, Climate, and the Clash of Nations. Daniel is the vice chairman of IHS Market and a Pulitzer Prize-winning author for his book, The Prize. He will be joined in conversation by Dr. Lawrence Jones, vice president for international programs at EEI. Throughout the session, please feel free to ask questions using the chat feature. Lawrence will aim to incorporate as many of them as possible into the conversation. Without further ado, I will turn this over to Lawrence to kick things off.
Thank you, Vanessa. Good morning, Dan. Welcome to this conversation. I believe, Dan, your phone, you're on mute, so you may want to unmute yourself, which is one of those challenges we have with Zoom these days. There you go. Great. Welcome, Dan. Again, as Vanessa said, we're delighted to have you with us here today. Dan, obviously one of the foremost thinkers in the world when it comes to energy, and Vanessa's already talked about your establishment of Cambridge Energy Research Associates, your many books, The Prize, The Quest, and obviously The Commanding Heights that you co-authored with Joseph Stanislaw. You've won the Pulitzer Prize, 1992, and those who do not know, this week you were actually named the Energy Writer of the Year by American Energy Society for your new book, The New Map. So congratulations on that. And welcome to this very interesting conversation we're going to have. Dan is no stranger to EEI, by the way. He's most recently was here with us for the EEI annual convention, where he moderated a panel that included, among others, former Secretary of Energy, Ernie Moniz. So Dan, welcome to EEI.
Well, thank you very much, Lawrence. I'm very glad to be here. Recognize the importance of this international program of EEI and how it's grown over the last several years and its significance in bringing the perspectives of the power industry together. And as you say, I very much have valued the long collaboration with EEI, with Tom Kuhn, and the other leaders of the organization. So I'm delighted to be here today with this international audience to talk about the new map.
So let's, first of all, Dana, normally when you hear about a leading thinker in energy or in any field, an expert, you always think of this person having been in this field all their life, right? To be an expert, you certainly need to be sort of entrenched in it from academic studies all the way through. But tell us about your journey to energy. Where did you develop your passion for energy? Because I guess that not, you didn't start in energy. Can you tell us a little bit about that journey to becoming
so? I started doing a PhD at Cambridge University. I'm an American, but I did it at Cambridge University, among other reasons, is because you can do it. They told me to go away and write a book. And so I wrote a book. And then I had a postdoctoral fellowship at Harvard for 2 years. And during that time, I had no one, the great virtue of no one was supervising me. And around that time, I just became obsessed with energy and the subject, because it stretches from everything from geopolitics to the most advanced technologies and markets in between, and capitalism and socialism, whatever the social organization is. And I ended up then teaching at the Harvard Business School and being part of the energy research project there. And that's what gave birth to both my work in business, leading to where I'm now vice chairman of IHS Market, when we have about 16,000 people around the world, but also gave me the opportunity to write a series of books, which somebody said to me are the books that come out around the turning points in the world energy. And we're at another turning point, and that's what the new map tries to lay out. So it was not I didn't start in this field as an undergraduate, but it was just that the subject is always so interesting, and what everybody on this call is involved in is so fundamental to how economies and societies operate. It's the foundation.
Interesting. So let me just probe you a little bit about the prize, the quest, the commanding heights, now the new map. Was there any sort of a common theme over the years that you've seen as you've written these books, or were there sequels to one another?
Well, some people describe the new map as the third book in a trilogy of the prize and the quest, and those are the ones that are closest together. And you know, you do see how the world really changes, and you have to stop sometimes and say how different. In the prize, China was hardly a factor, and that was the early 90s. China was at that point still self-sufficient in oil. It was in the quest, it was the only country that got two chapters, and it looms very large in the pages of the new map. But the other books too, you know, you get influenced. I realize all these books flow into each other. The Commanding Heights was about the changing relationship between state and markets, and about, we call it the rise of globalization. And now we see globalization becoming more fragmented. We see protectionism and a kind of nationalism, and difficult for companies that want to operate internationally, globally, more challenges emerging. And here's this real surprise for me, Lawrence. My first book was on the origins of the Cold War. It had some economics in it, and I did talk a little bit about energy in it, but that was about the Soviet-American Cold War, and I never thought I would be writing about the possibility of new Cold Wars. It just didn't really occur to me. And yet, as I was writing this book, I realized there's a risk, not like the Soviet-American Cold War, but certainly a kind of global competition that has some elements of it. And it's worrying for anybody who is interested in a well-functioning global economy. Mm-hmm. So I think it's, you know, without thinking about it, the themes that engage one and the perspective you develop from one book certainly flow into another. Mm-hmm. And I think the new map brings, really to me, my own surprise, brings them all together.
We'll come back to that. So I want to focus, so we're going to talk about the new map, and I like the subtitle, Energy, Climate, and the Clash of Nations. And before getting into the maps, I want to discuss climate change. And obviously the incoming Biden administration has sort of put energy and climate as the fourth pillar of their Build Back Better plan. And in fact, climate change issues are front and center for not just America leadership in the world. It's something that most people are asking for. So can you talk a little bit about, did this surprise you, the emphasis on climate by the incoming administration? And as a person who talked to world leaders, what are they expecting from the U.S. in terms of being viewed as a leader in climate?
I think that the, the book, as you know, is divided into a series of, let's call them metaphorical maps. And the last one, which is the really key one, is about climate. It's called the climate map, and it's about energy transition and climate policy. I think that it's clear that, you know, I guess you could summarize and say Joe Biden has a $2 trillion climate plan, and Donald Trump did not have a $2 trillion climate plan. And so I think it's going to pervade the administration. It's one of the pillars. I think it's every cabinet secretary will have a climate agenda. There may be some new positions of climate coordinators can create it. And very definitely the Biden administration is going to shift from that kind of focus on energy that you had in the Trump administration to climate and climate cooperation. And so I think they'll be kind of at the forefront and very active. And there's been 4 years of getting prepared and being ready for this. So this is going to be not only a pillar, but a priority. Obviously, how the politics go, depending on what happens in those Georgia elections in the Senate, will have an impact as to the different forces. There's a lot that you can do with presidential authority. Mm-hmm. I think that what's become clear with the Biden administration, which is different from some of the other Democrats, is that Biden has made clear he's not going to try and constrain, you know, ban fracking became the slogan by any means. He's a foreign policy guy, and he recognizes what it means for the U.S. to be basically self-sufficient and mm-hmm. independent, and what it does in terms of flexibility. So, you know, to mix metaphors, he'll be stepping on the gas when it comes to climate policy all across, and obviously the electric utility industry in the U.S. and elsewhere has already been moving towards lower carbon targets of net zero carbon. I emphasize net, and I think that will be accelerated, clearly will be accelerated under a Biden administration.
So, you know, it's often, and talk about the Biden administration and Biden himself, it's often said that how we deal with the problems we face today somehow prepares us for how we're going to handle greater challenges for the future. So in the case of President-elect Biden, you know, he had the challenge of dealing with the financial crisis under President Obama's term. He also then has moved and appointed his incoming chief of staff who dealt with the Ebola crisis. So now he has to deal with the coronavirus pandemic. He has to deal with the financial fallout of that, and also has to balance COVID-19 economic recovery and climate plans. How do you think he's going to be able to do that from your perspective? I mean, what pathway you think he's going to take, or what tools he's going to use to balance this trilogy of issues?
I think recovery, economic recovery, you know, if you, and not only the United States, but in so many countries, if you just walk down the street, you see shops that are closed, particularly what's happened to small business. And so I think everybody is going to be, you know, have a recovery agenda, try and link it to a climate agenda, but they're going to be very strong claims on governments. And you can already see a headline this morning about the amount of debt that governments have. Mm-hmm. So I think there will be choices there that will have to be made. The pressures will be there. And I think the sense of you have to deliver on what you say you're going to do on climate, but it's not going to be, if this was a prosperous time, if you didn't have COVID, if you didn't have recovery, it would be easier and more direct to do it. So choices will have to be made. And, you know, not just the United States, for other countries too. So, you know, the emphasis will be both on building back and on building back better.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting how that balance is walked, so to speak. So we'll come back to climate and the goals, because I want to talk to you about some of these goals that have been put forward across the world. But let's get back to the main framing in the book, which has to do with maps. You call it the new map, but in essence, you walk through multiple maps in the book, right? So as you describe the global energy system using maps, why maps? I mean, energy is such a complex topic. Why did you choose to use maps to describe?
Well, I think what first got me interested in it, or caught my eye, was just how the, you know, kind of wearing an economic historian hat, how trade flows were changing and investment flows were changing. The shift in the map of investment going into renewables as opposed to conventional generation, how the United States, which had imported 60% of its oil, now exporting 8 million barrels a day of oil. Mm. And just today, you know, increasing exports of oil and natural gas to China, working with India and seeing how India is importing energy from the United States, new pipelines, controversial pipelines from Russia to Europe, big new pipelines from Russia to China, or even looking at the Eastern Mediterranean. No one ever thought of that as an energy source. It's now potentially a large source of natural gas, and that's a new map in terms of where that gas goes and how it flows. So it was kind of that literal side of it, mm-hmm. but then it was, it's really the metaphor that the terrain has changed so dramatically in a decade. You have the shale revolution over there, which has done a lot to change world energy and a big impact on global politics. You also have what I've called a solar revolution, which is the fall in solar costs, which are so dramatic. Wind costs, and Lawrence, you know this very well, that how dramatically wind costs have come down and scale has gone up. And so you have that. And of course, I think the linchpin is the Paris Climate Agreement. And I came to the conclusion as I was writing this book, you now have two energy eras. You have before Paris and you have after Paris. And to see the way over the 5 years since then, Paris has become embedded in government policies, mm-hmm. ambitions, aspirations, how it's been embedded in the thinking of investors, and how it's in company strategies. And of course, it has been taken form in that goal of net zero carbon by 2050. And that's such a big change. And so that's the new terrain that, you know, wherever you are in the energy business, you kind of have to make your way across that terrain. And the new map is trying to provide a map or a guidebook from here to there, and a framework for how to think about it.
So let's dig a little deeper into a few of these maps, and maybe let's take perhaps what I would call one or two of the key mean futures that have disrupted the map for the respective region or country. So let's start with the U.S. What are the two mean disruptors you may see that have changed the U.S. map, if you may? And then we'll walk through a few of these maps. So let's start with the U.S. first.
Well, in the U.S., it's clearly shale. I mean, this was something that was just, the textbook said it wasn't possible. And, you know, there are great forces and technology come together, and sometimes people really matter. And there's this guy named George P. Mitchell, who for 18 years believed that you could get natural gas out of shale rock, and he needed to do it because he had contracts to fulfill, including 10% of Chicago's natural gas. And people said it was crazy. And then you have the accident of somebody going to a baseball game in Dallas, Texas, sitting next to somebody else who says, you know, try this instead of that, and it works. And you have this thing that first the rest of the world thought was a bubble, but then turned out to make the United States the world's largest producer of oil and natural gas in just a decade, instead of ever more dependent on imports. And it has had a big financial impact, a big impact on manufacturing, a big impact on investment, on government revenues. It's had an impact on US foreign policy. And I think it's been a contribution to energy security, as we saw a year ago, September, when missiles hit the most important piece of infrastructure in the world, oil and gas industry, which is this ABQAIQ facility in Saudi Arabia. And instead of causing panic, the market just kind of adjusted to it because you had this change. So still controversial in the United States, but on the other hand, a big industry that has created several million jobs. So that's on one side. I think on the other side is the degree to which climate has become a much more pervasive theme in American politics and American national discussion and a mobilization of people. So I put those are two of the big things in this country. And I think the pivot in electric utilities in the US, I mean, you mentioned that EEI CEO forum, Lawrence, and it's very interesting. I think, and you and Tom and your colleagues, if you stand back and said, it's a different perspective among utilities than it was 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm. So one question has already come in, and since you mentioned natural gas being one of the sort of the game-changing elements of the U.S. New energy map, if you may, what do you think is the future of natural gas going forward in terms of this new map? How should we see it?
Well, we know the impact natural gas has had in the U.S. U.S. CO2 emissions are down to the level of 1990, although the economy has doubled. And that's largely because gas has replaced coal in electric generation. Now it's, I think gas is gonna grow, but I think it's also obviously more controversial. I think Europe is particularly, European policy is not particularly friendly to natural gas right now. And other parts of the world, India, big emphasis on wind and solar. We just did our India Energy Forum. We had Prime Minister Modi and four of his cabinet ministers, and they're committed to wind and solar, but they're also committed to a $60 billion natural gas infrastructure to get energy to poor people and to help clean up the economy. So I think growth in emerging markets, in electric generation, competing with renewables in electric generation, gas also being a partner to renewables in electric generation. And in our own numbers at IHS Market, we see on average LNG growing at about 3% a year for the next two decades. But I think there'll be more battles over it. And I think there'll be more looking at alternatives, and particularly in Europe, to natural gas. Obviously, top of the agenda now is hydrogen, biogas, what else you could put in the pipelines. But natural gas actually, we think it will come to be as large as oil in terms of share of total world energy. So I know not everybody will agree with that, but I think that, and we will have a world in which, you know, just as in oil, we have a big three today, which is the United States, Saudi Arabia, and Russia. We'll have a big three in LNG, which will be Qatar, Australia, the United States, and probably a big fourth, which will be Russia, because they've cracked the code on Arctic LNG.
So let's then look at a few other global maps, since the audience here is very global. Let's look at some of the global maps. So maybe for in this segment, maybe you give me sort of a one major game-changing element in each of these respective maps we want to talk about. Let's start first with the Russia map, the China map, and then the Middle Eastern map. And then a couple of other maps which you didn't address in the book, but I've gotten some questions from the audience as to why you didn't address those maps. So let's spend the next maybe 5 minutes walking through these maps. Let's start with the Russia energy map. What's the big thing there that has changed?
Well, first of all, let me say why I didn't include everything is that this book is only half the length of the prize. And in the age of Twitter, you can't have long books anymore. So that's my apology, but I did kind of squeeze it into other sections. I think for Russia, it's restoration as a great power, although it has an economy that's in size between that of Italy and Spain. And that energy has been a very critical part of it. I think the second thing I would say is this deepening relationship between Russia and China. A relationship that was once based on Marx and Lenin is to some significant part today based on oil and gas. Although, I mean, it has very geopolitical issues in it. And I think the third thing is the Russian reaction to shale. In the book, I describe a time when I was at a conference in St. Petersburg and Putin was speaking and Chancellor Merkel were the two speakers. And I was asked to ask the first question. And it was to a question that would be a perennial question today. What are you going to do about diversifying your economy so you're not so dependent on hydrocarbons for exports, for earnings? It's like half the Russian budget. And by accident, I mentioned the word shale. And at that, President Putin got very irritated and literally started shouting and very uncomfortable to be shouted at in front of 3,000 people. Mm-hmm. And he didn't like shale. He saw shale for two reasons. One, he saw it taking market share away from Russia, particularly in Europe in terms of natural gas. And secondly, because he sees this as something, an adjunct to US foreign policy, actually, as we get into the sensitive geopolitical issues. Mm-hmm. So. And then I think what's striking to me, I think, you know, you put it in an interesting way, Lawrence, I think it's, talk about Russia, China, I think the way Russia has developed its position in the Middle East, where it's the only country, major country that can talk to everybody on all sides, and has developed this new relationship with Saudi Arabia, that is the basis of what's called OPEC Plus, which has been the stabilizer of the world oil market for the last several years when it works.
And so if that's Russia, China sort of a tied together. Obviously China map is an interesting one. Can you say a few words on the China map?
Yeah, China is really interesting. And there's no question that the most important geopolitical issue in the world in the next several decades is going to be the relationship between the United States and China. And in the new map, I went back and found all these statements that presidents talked about constructive engagement with a changing China, things like that. The language has changed in both, I think, Washington and Beijing. It's strategic rivals now, it's great power competition, which kind of echoes before the First World War in terms of the language that's brought it back. China is, by some measures, already the largest economy in the world, or will be the largest economy in the world. Energy is critical. It's still an economy, not just in terms of electricity, overall energy dependent on almost coal for about 60%, but wanting to obviously move away from that. And I talk about two maps, literal maps, but that are very significant metaphorically and geopolitically. One is the 9-line map for the South China Sea, which is the most important body of water in the world from the world economy. 1/3 of world trade passes through it. And it's, you know, there's a lot of tension around those claims, China's claim that the South China Sea is Chinese territory, and that's rejected by other countries. And You've seen near collisions between US and Chinese ships and naval ships in the South China Sea. The other is the map, which was interesting to put together. What is the map of the Belt and Road Initiative, the $1.4 trillion Chinese initiative to connect China, Central Asia, South Asia, Middle East, Africa, Europe, and even Panama, actually. And that has, both of these have large energy components in them. South China Sea is because China imports 75% of its oil, and Belt and Road, one of the major elements of it, is energy. So I think it's the way China is seeking to move, and the way China, I think, has taken a commanding position in what you might call new energy, source of 70% of the world's solar panels, lithium ion battery supply chain, rare earths. But it's a mixed picture because half the electric cars in the world, half the solar, half the wind, seems half of everything is in China. But at the other hand, they're still building between 3 and 5 new coal-fired plants a month. So, even if the economy is not growing at 10% a year anymore, it still needs continuing supplies of energy. And that looms large for the decision makers in Beijing.
That brings me then to, let's spend a few more minutes just talking about another map in the book, which is the Middle Eastern map. And then two maps we didn't talk about in the book, obviously didn't have time, but I'd love to get your perspectives on the EU map, if you may, and the map of Africa, two very interesting places. So maybe we talk first about maybe the Middle Eastern map and then get your thoughts on the EU map and then what you see for the African energy map going forward, if you could just share your thoughts.
Well, for the EU map, for the Middle East map, I want to go there first. I was really struck when I saw on the internet an ISIS video, an ISIS militant stomping his feet in the sand on what he said was the border between Iraq and Syria, saying, "We're erasing Sykes-Picot." Most of the people on this webinar will say, "What is Sykes-Picot?" Sykes-Picot was a map that was drawn in 1916 during World War I to try and figure out what the organization of the Middle East would be afterwards. After the war, and it continues. It wasn't exactly what emerged from it, but it's become the symbol of the kind of system of nation states and people who want to overturn that system. Mm-hmm. And that continues today. And you look at the map, much of what's happened in the Middle East is the contention on the ground between, call it, on the one side, Iran and its proxies, and the other side, Saudi Arabia and other countries in the region, and that contention goes on. But I think the change there is the focus on diversifying economies. Abu Dhabi has been really done a remarkable job showing what can be done. Saudi Arabia is trying to do it. It's hard to do it during COVID. It's hard to even do it when it's not COVID. And it turns out in order to shift away from oil, diversify your economy away from oil, actually you need a lot of oil revenues to do it. So I think kind of that's where the Mideast is, and we'll see the degree to which the Biden administration can seek to restore the agreement with Iran on nuclear development, and how difficult it will be with many ramifications for the region. So that's what I look at. And then if we turn to the EU, the EU, has set its goal to be net zero, the first net zero carbon economy continent by 2050. And that's the goal Ursula von Leyen, the president of the EU, has set out. And it has a complex program to do that. One of the books I wrote, you mentioned, was The Commanding Heights, and it is kind of retaking the Commanding Heights by government, because it has very strong regulatory, would be very strong regulatory intervention, and indeed controlling the allocation of capital to do that. Mm-hmm. Very ambitious, cost not very clear, but that's the goal. And, as the Europeans know, they call it, not to be confused with the program here, they call it the Green Deal. And that is set now as a priority for the EU. Again, a continent that's also going to have a lot of lasting economic problems in terms of recovery. But you can see it with the announcement this week by Boris Johnson, although he's not in the EU anymore, but the European perspective of no new internal combustion engine cars sold after 2030, which is, need to point out, is only 10 years away.
Yeah.
So that's the EU. On Africa, Lawrence, I think we can say Africa and emerging markets and developing countries in general. I have a quote in the new map from the energy minister of Nigeria saying it's fine for the Netherlands and Germany to do what they want to do, but our problems are really different. We have a lot of poor people who need energy, who need to be less poor. We need to improve their health. We need to get more natural gas to them. We need to get commercial energy to them. And it's the same thing in India. The World Health Organization says that the biggest single environmental problem in the world is indoor air pollution that comes from cooking with wood, with animal waste, with crop waste, and that you've got to get away from that. Mm-hmm. And that's why looking to commercial energy as a way to do it. So it's a very different perspective. And, you know, I was thinking, you know, decades ago, people used to talk about a north-south clash in the world economy. There's a different north-south clash, and I think it's a north-south clash over energy and getting the balance between climate objectives and poverty reduction and objectives and health improvement objectives.
Yeah, and finding that balance is going to be a very interesting sort of a dilemma the world is going to face. We saw that in Paris, at, you know, the whole negotiation part of this thing was what would be the role of the developing nations vis-a-vis the OECD countries. So one, coming a little bit into geopolitics. So there's one word that basically permeates all energy policies across the world, more or less, by governments, and that is independence, energy independence. You hear this a lot. And now we have a lot of push to go to high penetration renewables. In some cases, people are asking for 100% renewable. Now, I'm intrigued by independence and dependency, where becoming independent of one resource, and so you end up becoming dependent on another. And I'm thinking specifically here, when you talk about wind and solar, the technology being developed elsewhere, 70% being developed, for example, in China in the case of wind and solar. So what do we, how do we view this whole issue of wanting energy independence, but inadvertently creating another dependency? How do we balance that out? And what are the challenges from a supply chain perspective, Dan?
Yeah, well, that's the, I mean, our current major research project at IHS Markit that I'm involved in is exactly that question, the new supply chains for the net zero carbon economy. Because I don't think that there's, you know, you tend to look at your own thing, what your own project or what you're doing. But I've often found to kind of get a systemic view is something that kind of only happens when you kind of run up against a wall or you run up against a problem. And I think that the scale of what will be involved in getting to net zero carbon, the sun is free, the wind is free, not the metals, not the minerals. And, you know, the, one of the favorite things in the media is to use this phrase, big oil. I think we'll be talking about big shovels. We'll be talking about a lot of digging, moving materials from one place to another. And that, I think, the scale of the supply chains needs to be looked at. And we're trying to do it in a very granular way to understand where the bottlenecks are to meet the objective so you don't have a collision with everybody trying to do the same thing at the same time. I think there's also, you know, 100% renewables. Well, actually, you're going to be using plastics there. The bodies of electric vehicles will require a lot of plastics. So in fact, being renewable doesn't mean that you're free actually of the hydrocarbons, the plastics in that sense. So, and I think also inevitably two things are going to intrude, because up to now, you know, supply chains have been about efficiency, about technology, about economics. Over here is geopolitics. And we had the sense, and this goes back to what we were talking about before, of an open world economy. You didn't really have to think about those things. Well, there's so many barriers, direct barriers and indirect barriers going up as kind of tensions break down, as suspicions among countries increase. And that's going to affect the flow. So you're gonna have kind of geopolitics, I think, in intruding. And also, of course, as you know, Lawrence, and the US utilities and European particularly, very much engaged with the ESG questions. My electricity is very efficient, and so I have to stand up to get the light on in the room again, because I haven't moved. ESG is, I think, will come to be applied to the supply chains for net zero economy too, net zero carbon economy, and I think those will be considerations as well. So when you get, can it get to the scale where this is going, where policy and company strategies, investors want, it's going to create demands on a scale that I think are just not being anticipated now. So I think that's a really big question. And that's why this, what should we call it? This kind of increasing friction in the global economy is a real concern. You know, Lawrence, just to, you think about, you mentioned the financial crisis of 2008, you had a very collaborative reaction among nations to deal with it. Amazing. The G20 for a time became like the board of directors of the world economy. Mm-hmm. We sure didn't see that with COVID. We saw nationalism, you know, each country trying to go its own way, lack of cooperation. I think this terrible pandemic, this tragic pandemic could have been handled better if there had been international cooperation. And I think that doesn't bode well for dealing with the kind of ambitions one has for the global economy, including dealing with climate.
Mm-hmm. And when you mentioned the supply chain, you know, that supply chain, another word in your book, Dan, is the issue of diversification, not just resource diversification, but even supply chain diversification. And just to piggyback a little bit, when you mentioned the whole issue of the supply chain, I think in terms of rare earth metals that are necessary for the renewable space and EVs, I think Africa has an opportunity to sort of not just be a supply of rare earth metals, but to actually be part of the supply chain. So you could see an interesting disruption coming to the supply chain if African governments were to start working collaboratively, say with say the US and Europe and others, to sort of build some of the supply chain in Africa because you have the natural resources there.
You know, Lawrence, that's a very interesting idea that, you know, I don't think has been talked much about, but in terms of, you know, yes, why, you know, supply chains could be more direct as well as more diversified. Mm-hmm. And, you know, diversification, whether it's your own retirement funds or supply chains for net zero carbon, diversification is kind of a good idea. Mm-hmm. But that's very interesting. I know India certainly is looking at how do they develop their own supply chains. Mm-hmm. But there's a challenge at the same time as being competitive because, you know, the supply chains that now exist for solar are what's brought down the cost so dramatically.
Before we leave climate map, just before we move to the climate map, there's a question have come in I think you'd like to address here. And basically, is basically unlike SOx, NOx, and mercury, CO2 is ubiquitous in that it's worldwide concentration. So what happens one place affects everybody else, right? And so if reductions that you try to do, you want to be net zero, but the other person doesn't want to be net zero, as a globe, you have the negative impact of still having this issue of CO2 emissions going up. So I think the gist of the question here is, how do we find consensus on this issue of balancing the, you know, net emissions targets around the world? And so I think a question tied to that is when you talk in the book about climate map and you talk about the energy transition, you try to define it, which you did an excellent job characterizing it being different for different places. But I would like to see if you can talk about where you see there is no consensus as to the speed of the transition, nor what the transition will look like a decade from now, nor the cost of the transition, nor how it's going to be achieved. So given lack of consensus on these big questions, why was the Paris deal so important and what made it work?
Well, I think what fundamentally, remember Paris followed on a disastrous meeting in Copenhagen, which ended in chaos. And so this one was carefully prepared. And you know what was really the basis of it, Lawrence, was the deal that was made the year before when Barack Obama and Xi Jinping in the Great Hall in Beijing agreed on they came to an agreement on how to proceed on climate. And that was the foundation on which Paris depended. Without that agreement between the United States and China, China produces about 29% of CO2, the US about 15% right now. I have a great graphic in the book that breaks that all down. Without those two nations being on board, it wasn't gonna happen. So that was really the floor for the Paris Agreement. And it is, Lawrence, in sort of international relations history, this Paris is really unusual to have 195 nations sign on to something, not exactly a treaty, but a consensus. And so Paris has become the benchmark and it's become embedded, as we were saying before. But different countries are going to go about it differently and have different priorities. You know, you just look again, I mentioned this, you know, the debt problems of emerging markets, they're going to have a really big financial difficulty, including the, you know, African countries, Asian countries, Latin American countries, because of COVID and because of what's happened to the world economy because of COVID. Mm-hmm. So Europe has a plan, and it's called border taxes or border adjustment taxes, on the premise that you can't have carbon pricing in your own territory and have materials that come in from other countries that don't have carbon pricing because your industry will not be competitive. Mm. And it's also meant to put pressure. I think this is very much on the agenda of the EU, and it's going to proceed with that. Certainly will be a topic for the Biden administration. Mm-hmm. I think it will also be very contentious. Already, Vladimir Putin said about 2 weeks ago, he said nothing good will come of this. So I think that's going to be a real area of international discord. Mm-hmm. And in a sense, might to some degree undermine the global consensus around the Paris objectives, targets, you know, whatever you want to call them. Mm-hmm. Each countries are going to move on, but it will weaken it if you have a really big battle over that. And then there'll be the question whether border adjustment taxes actually work under the World Trade Organization. Mm-hmm. So I think that will be, you know, where we've had a lot of agreement among countries, we might start to see some disagreement in the way you're pointing to, and very troubling for emerging market countries.
Yeah, and what's interesting, so Paris has been 5 years and counting, and climate change today, as we started off, is at front and center for most governments around the world. A lot of people have net zero targets. I find it intriguing that these numbers, these dates, they're either like, you know, 2030, 35, 40, 50, 60. There's nobody who has a date for 2037, for example. So I'm just intrigued as to why all these sort of interesting numbers you can divide. But the same is true for cities. I mean, cities are, you know, putting on their targets. One interesting group are the investors. I listened to an interview earlier this week, a conversation with Larry Fink, and he talked about, you know, sustainable investments, ESG, which you've already mentioned. So considering the cost of the corona pandemic, virus pandemic, and all the debt, how will climate finance work? I mean, how are we going to fund this thing? If governments don't have money, what kind of regulatory structures and policy signals needs to be put in place so that investors can come to this space for us to make this work? Because it seems to me that investors are ready to move, listening to Larry, yeah. Fink, right? So what needs to happen?
Yeah, I mean, you go to Europe where they're going to control the allocation of capital, and they will also, as I understand, investors will have to say whether their portfolios are compliant with the objectives. The ESG development over the last year and a half has been pretty explosive. And you talk to companies, I'm sure many on this call know that, you're getting not one letter from investors, but you're getting a lot of different letters from investors, and you're also getting a lot of different people offering, giving you questionnaires to rate you, and they're often contradictory. In response to that, we at IHS Markit have set up what we call the ESG reporting repository, where companies can put their information and have it sorted so it could be compared to other companies and useful for investors. But I think Larry Fink, CEO of BlackRock, when BlackRock speaks, a lot of people listen, given that it owns shares and seems almost so many of the companies around the world. And of course, the indexes. So it's going to, ESG is only going to become a bigger factor. And companies are going to be asked, how are you compliant with the Paris objective, which is, that's the benchmark. So I think the role of investors will have a big impact. At the same time, of course, investors also want returns. You know, you talk about the difference between a Trump administration, a Biden administration. The Trump SEC was questioning the claims by socially impact investment funds that they give better returns. I think, you know, that people say here with you've got to look and see what happens to the Senate, what happens. But I think in the United States, at least, you also got to keep your eye on the Securities and Exchange Commission and the degree to which it puts climate or ESG considerations into evaluations.
Yeah, I mean, ESG is actually very important to the point where EEI had an initiative that led to sort of the ESG template that was developed with, you know, with the financial industry. And so I think it's something that even our sector is focused on, and I think it's something we're going to see moving forward. So we've talked about the financial aspect. Let's get to the technology. All of these goals being set, all these ambitious goals, do we have the technology, Dan, to get us there? And if not, how do we get there? And what are some of the technologies? Can you name two or three of the technologies that you think would be sort of a game changing going forward?
So we did a study with Ernie Moniz for Bill Gates Foundation, Breakthrough Energy, on all the technologies we don't have, because I think, you know, if you sort of said, what are the questions you need to ask about the energy transition in a very practical way in terms of achieving it, not in terms of rhetoric and bad ambitions, targets, you know, just kind of a checklist. We've talked about some of them, supply chains, geopolitics, scale, all of those things. But I think technology, I mean, the kind of point of view I have at the end of the day, it's about technology, and there are just a lot that we don't have right now. And, so I put at the top, you know, clearly hydrogen is really hot. Hydrogen was a big subject 15 years ago. California had a hydrogen highway. It turned out the hydrogen highway went nowhere. But I think a lot of people from a lot of different perspectives are looking at hydrogen. And of course, as many on this call know, there's blue hydrogen made from natural gas and green hydrogen where you apply, use renewables, extra generation of electricity to electrolysis. I'd say a second one that I think looms really large is carbon capture, or carbon capture use and storage. And it's not there yet by any means, but you know, wind and solar, modern wind and solar are 50-year-old technologies. It was only within the last 10 years they've become mature and you've seen these real fall in costs. So, I mean, there are things like direct air capture, a whole host of technologies. And so developing that, I think, is a very important one. Obviously, what looms large for utilities around the world is the ability to store electricity. And Lawrence, you know something about this, and you've worked in this field. Getting to where you can store it, you know, for many hours will be really key if renewables, wind and solar are going to become more like baseload and not have that big variation. Mm-hmm. So I think, and a lot of work's going on that. I'm on the external advisory board at MIT's Energy Initiative, and you see work going on in all of these areas. I think biology, that kind of ties into carbon capture, the role of plants is another one. And then you can sort of go down a whole host of other things that, maybe also our own experience, what we're doing today, digitalization is itself is a technology that Yesterday, I was talking with a CEO of one of the major airlines, and for all the people in the call, what's going to be the future of business travel when you can travel around the world digitally? So there's no single technology. And I saw one question came up about small nuclear reactors.
I was just about to ask you that question. So you read my mind.
People in many countries are not going to build traditional new nuclear reactors. They will in some parts of the world. We've seen in the UAE, they've done that in other countries. So the question is small nuclear reactors. And at least the count I've seen that in the United States alone, there are over 60 companies and research projects working on advanced nuclear designs. And it would seem that, nuclear actually in a new form would be part, if you want zero carbon electricity, that would be something that you would need. Obviously, nuclear technology is not like software. It doesn't happen overnight. It has to go through a considerable licensing and examination period. But I would think, I don't know, Lawrence, I'm going to ask you, what do you think?
Well, I think you're onto something here. I mean, we have a lot of, we see a lot of development. I mean, in Canada, for example, OPG, they're pushing their, small modular reactor project. We see other countries around the world where they're pushing small modular reactors. So I think nuclear is going to have a role to play here. And like you said in the book and others have said, it's about making sure the economics work, but also, the importance of, emissions reduction and sustainable development will make nuclear part of the equation here. I want to get to electrification because for many, electrification is perhaps one of the most important pathways to achieving most of the climate goals we have. So how do you see electricity affecting the energy maps you've talked about? Can you just give us your view on electrification and how important it is?
I think electrification is happening in all sorts of different dimensions. You can look at the growth of electrification for residential heating. That's an important example. And you kind of go down the list of all the activities that are going to be electrified. We'll see how fast transportation is electrified, kind of the scale that's involved and the ambitions and targets, and it gets into your supply chain. But, it's interesting. Oil and gas used to grow in lockstep with GDP, that's now split. But electricity consumption continues to grow with GDP, and I think that's this big indicator. And of course, just this digital world that we're in, and the dependence, the cloud, so I'd say that you can look in all different sectors, and electrification is the direction in which the world is moving, and will be much more so the kind of motive force of the world economy.
Mm. One other question regarding electricity, though. We have a lot of energy companies who are looking at the electricity sector as the place to be. They're trying to sort of reposition themselves. Do you see that as a new trend where traditional non-electric companies that are energy companies will try to find a way to enter this space? And if they do, why would they, and what's the upside and the downside?
Not only will this be a trend, it is a trend right now. I mean, we look at every single one of the major European oil and gas majors, what used to be called IOCs, international oil companies, mm-hmm. now branding themselves as integrated energy companies, IEC, mm. and saying, well, some of them are already experienced in wind, but seeing the trend, taking big positions in the electric charging industry, in electric generation, owning utilities, all of that. Here goes my, we have such efficient electricity, that doesn't want to waste a drop. So it's, seeing electricity as a growth business that they want to be in. Now, it is a different business, different returns. Mm-hmm. Traditionally, oil and gas is seen as having higher returns, not in the last several years. Electricity, more stable returns. You have a different kind of regulatory environment. But and if you look at things like offshore wind, you know, oil and gas companies have worked offshore for a long time, so they have a lot of skill in that. And what they do bring to it is that they're, you know, big engineering companies. That's what they are essentially, that execute large scale projects. So they're going to enter it. I don't know whether, as you're thinking about it, Lawrence, you're seeing this as becoming a more crowded field, or whether you see that this, your, the International Electricity Program of EEI will start to have new companies coming in who have not been members.
Well, we'll see how it evolves. You make a good point.
But they've made big commitments, and that partly has to do with not only the regulatory pressure from governments, not only seeing electrification you're talking about, but obviously the pressure from investors. Mm-hmm. There'll be more people crowding into it, and they'll say they bring skills in electricity trading and ability to offer a total package to a large tech company that needs electricity for its server farms and so forth. I guess kind of as you asked the question, I'm thinking about it, is people are seeing electricity is the place to be.
It is the place to be, and I'm not biased by saying that. So we're coming up to the end of our conversation, Dan, and I want to end with a question. Well, not me asking a question, but I'm going to ask you to ask three questions, or to tell us three questions that you think we should be thinking about. And the reason why is that in the book, you say mapping the path to a low carbon world would be a defining challenge in the decades ahead. You also say that energy transition is complex. And then you say that in this era of rising tension, in fact, I think it's your last sentence, and a fragmenting global order, the clash of nations is another predictable disruption. So these are all big, big challenging issues. I believe that before we try to address them, we should really look at some of the hard questions. So let us end by you telling us three big questions that we should be thinking about as we leave this conversation, and we should really spend our time thinking about. What are the three questions you will ask us to think about?
Well, off the top, I mean, that's an awesome responsibility with no time to think about it. But I think that, the scale of the change and how smoothly it goes or not in the scale of it. I think secondly, I put this issue, maybe I'll say for supply chains, I think it's really important. Making sure that we have the flow of technology, because technology doesn't happen overnight. You know, it takes time and commitment to get from discovery to innovation. And then I think, it's not the responsibility of this industry and the people on the call, but trying to manage the growing international tensions, because I think that will provide that will be the arena in which the world economy functions, climate policy functions, world trade functions, all of these things. And so I would say, understanding that, and to the degree that one can contribute to it or help keep things on a more even keel, and not get into this polarization of suspicion and each side doubting the other's intentions, would be very important in terms of shaping the whole environment in which all these other things will unfold. So those are some thoughts that I would put at the top of the agenda.
Well, it's great. And I think we didn't spend enough time talking about the geopolitics, but I think it's safe to say, Dan, that in our field, energy, anyone involved in energy globally is in essence an energy diplomat, because energy diplomacy is going to be key. Going back to Benjamin Franklin, you know, he was a diplomat. And I think what you're doing and what most people in our profession is doing from a global standpoint is being energy diplomats, if you may. So final question, Dan.
I think that's a really important point, Lawrence, that particularly as the internationalization goes on, working across borders, and that what companies do is a very important component to the overall system in terms of stabilizing it and maintaining to the best possible and strengthening the links. on the commercial, the technical side, is a real contribution. So I think your point is a very powerful one.
So finally, last question, Dan. We've had the quest, we've had the prize, we now have the new map. So what's next and when can we expect it?
Well, I'll say every time I start on a book, I always think it will be X hard and then it turns out to be 4X hard. So I'm reluctant to say. Right now, as I say, I'm thinking about supply chains, but I think it will be kind of how what's happening in the global economy with energy and everything else fits into this larger geopolitical picture, and returning to the subjects about how do we maintain an open world economy in which investment can flow, technology can flow, commerce can flow, people can flow, students can flow, and not see the doors start to close. So I think that's an area that I'd like to work on when I catch my breath.
Well, Dan, thank you so much for your time. Congratulations again on the recognition as the sort of the Energy Writer of the Year. I think it's certainly up there when it comes to the Pulitzer Prize. So congratulations. We really enjoy this conversation. I recommend anyone who hasn't read the book, it's a good Christmas read. If you have nothing else to do for the holiday season, pick up one of Dan's book, The New Map. And we look forward to following up with you, Dan. And again, thanks for joining us here at EEI International Program. And I also want to thank EEI President Tom Kuhn, who actually nudged me to making sure we could get you, Dan, to come and talk on this on this program. So many thanks to Tom for suggesting that.
Well, thank you, Lawrence. And certainly thank you to Tom, who's a great friend and has been a great leader, not only in the U.S. electric power industry, but in the United States in general and around the world for the electric power industry. So thank you and congratulations on this great program that you've built and the importance of this program in dealing with many of the questions that we've been talking about today. So thank you for the opportunity. And thank you to everybody who's joined us.
Thank you. With that, I'll turn it over to Vanessa, who will have any last minute actions that you may want to take to follow up with us. Thank you so much, Dan. Over to you, Vanessa.
Thank you, Lawrence. Thank you, Dan, for all of your insights. And thank you to everyone for joining today's conversation and asking so many thoughtful questions. We will be sending out a recording to all attendees, which we will also be sharing on our YouTube channel, where you can find recordings from other past virtual conversations and webinars. So I've put the link to our YouTube channel in the chat. To continue engaging with EEI International Programs and to learn about other upcoming events, please follow us on Twitter or visit our website. And thank you all again, and have a wonderful rest of your day.
Thanks. See you, Dan. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.